What kinds of things would you do on a daily basis?
On a daily basis, how about the grocery shopping, taking care of everything? Working in the studio, I was their production assistant, doing clothes, doing the publicity, answering the phones.
John hadn't spoken with his son for 2 years, when one day, I took a call from Julian. He said,
I'd like to speak to my dad.
But all calls had to be vetted first by Yoko.
This is Yoko.
So I said, Julian's on the line. The first words out of her mouth was,
you gotta get rid of the call. This call never happened.
And I was just really taken aback to go into that call and say, I'm sorry, your father's not here. Julian again called back a week or two later, and again, I wasn't allowed to put the call through. And finally, at one point I said, Yoko, it's Julian again. And she said,
you can put the call through, but if John should ask you, is this the first time he's called? You say, yes.
I buzzed John. Julian's on the line. And he said,
is this the first time he's called?
And I said, yes, I had to lie. But what could I do? Yoko was my boss, but then so was John. So I lied to John. And I lied to Julian, and it hurt. Yoko was using me, simple as that. And not for the last time. I've been John and Yoko's personal assistant. But now, I was convinced I was about to lose my job.
I came to work one morning, and Yoko walked into my office at the Dakota and said, John and I are not getting along, and I know he's going to start seeing other people, and I want you to go out with him because I know he needs someone nice like you.
And it just sort of snapped me back into reality, and I said, excuse me?
I want you to understand, I didn't start this. And she said, no, I know that. We've been having problems.
And you were a 22-year-old secretary at the time, right?
Right. I've been working for them about two and a half years at that point.
How'd you feel when she asked you to have an affair with her?
I was stunned. I didn't know what to express. Are you kidding? I can't do that. He's my employer. He's my boss. I said, he's your husband. And she says, no, it's okay. You should go and do it.
I want you to go out with him. I know you'll be nice. I know he likes you. You'll go out with him. I said, no. And she said, yes, you will. And she got up and walked out of the room.
How does this come about?
You know, I was a naive kid. I was very, very young at that point. You know, she started telling me all sorts of things. You'll be fine. And I said, no, I don't want to. That's your husband. She says, no, I want you to go out with him.
She ordered you to have an affair with her husband.
Yeah, she thought it was the best thing since I didn't have a boyfriend.
Of course Yoko had her own version of what happened. When Yoko decided to interview, well, Yoko.
Is it true that you arranged the love story between John and his assistant, Nathan?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't think it was an arrangement. It was convenient for John to have an assistant, and she was a very good assistant, a very capable person.
Really didn't think it was part of the job. I got a little freaked out. I didn't understand what was coming. She had some weird ideas before, but this topped it.
You had no romantic feelings for John?
Not at the time.
Yoko knew that John was going to start fooling around on her.
Right.
Yoko knew she could control you.
That's true.
Yoko picked the safe choice. Here, John, go have some fun with May, knowing that she could reel him back in anytime she wanted.
She was, as you paint her, Yoko Ono, trying to control the affair, control John, control you. And she continued to encourage you.
Right.
Yoko set it up, John's wife.
She actually virtually insisted.
Why did you do it?
John, in the end, pursued me.
We started to spend a lot of time together at the studio, alone. He began to flirt and pay more attention to me.
When we got into the elevator, when we were going to the recording studio, he turned around and he grabbed me and he kissed me. And I said, just stand over there. I said, don't do this to me. And he said, because I've been waiting to do this all day.
asked a million times, what happened? What changed since you told Yoko no? Well, what happened was, John. He looked me in the eye. He whispered in my ear. And then he kissed me. And before I knew it, John Lennon charmed the pants off of me. After we made love, I started to cry. What does this mean? He said, I don't know. Next morning, John called me into his office and did something that really surprised me. He opened up his guitar case and said, I want you to hear something. All right. Just like a willow tree.
Just like a willow tree.
A breath of spring, you see.
A breath of spring, you see.
She gets me through this god-awful loneliness. Much John meant to me. Up until that moment, I didn't realize how much I meant to John. John and I spent nights together. And every morning I would go to the Dakota and see Yoko. It was not a comfortable situation for me. This myth that Yoko sent us to L.A. to be together is nothing but a myth. But what really happened, one day John said, we gotta get out of New York, May. Just the two of us, away from Yoko. The whole thing was so spontaneous. We talked at noon, and at 6 p.m., we were at the airport. And that's how the Lost Weekend really began. John called me every night. He couldn't believe the reception he got in Central Park. He told me, come home, May. I actually began to think our relationship had survived the so-called Lost Weekend. I returned to New York. To my great relief, I found John clean and sober.
By then, I'd straightened myself out. I was straight and, you know, no drink.
John decided we should move in together. We ended up finding the perfect apartment. Can you imagine? I was 23, and my first live-in boyfriend was John Lennon. We had a view of the East River, which reminded John of the Mersey in Liverpool.
I remember the apartment very well. It was a really small apartment. It wasn't Tittenhurst, no. It was on the top floor, I believe, and very steep stairs. The view was amazing. It was like being in a little bit of a castle on top of the building, overlooking New York and the river. It was a very, very special little spot.
We took the bedroom, and we fixed up the guest room for Julian.
Everything, people always looking at people like me, trying to see some secret, or what do they do, you know? Do they go to the bathroom? Do they eat?
Do you?
I do, quite a lot.
It was an absolute joy and a pleasure. It was just Dad and May, and it was just a happy, happy time, especially in some of the photographs. You can see that May took of Dad and I together.
We even had cats, Major and Minor, which John named after the black and white keys on the piano. As an actual New Yorker, I showed John around the real New York.
I love it, you know. I mean, people just say hi, or, you know, what's cooking, and a few people ask for autographs, but mainly they just sort of wave or shake your hand, and I get about and I go to eat, and I'm enjoying all the things I couldn't do for 10 years, you know?
I seem to be the guy in New York that all the Englishmen say hi to, you know. which is good, you know, if Mick's in town, Paul's in town, anybody comes, I love it, you know.
Paul McCartney used to say, you know, come over to our house, and Ringo and George and Elton.
All these people had their best times with John when he was with May, and Mick has acknowledged that was when John was with May was the time that he got to really see it. You know, everybody saw John when he was with May.
Funny bit, we were trying to get in touch with Paul and Linda for dinner. We didn't reach them, we left them a message, and as we're coming up 61st Street in the cab, we look over in the other cab, and it's Paul and Linda. And all of a sudden, we yell out, and the two Beatles, right, John and Paul, stick their heads out, and they're screaming at one another, saying, I'll talk to you later, and as the car's moving, they split. And it's wild to see that.
John's favorite place in our apartment was out on the balcony. And that's where I took a picture of Bob Gruen taking his famous picture.
I remember Dad and May showing me where they were on the rooftops and they'd seen the UFO. Love the story and the idea that that happened.
We saw a UFO one night and there were two of us standing nude looking at this thing with no noise, nothing.
Over here, up there, I saw a UFO and it went down the river, turned right at the United Nations, turned left and then down the river, and it looked dark, like black or gray in the middle, and had white lights, just looked like light bulbs, you know? Just going off, on, off, on, off, on, blink, 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 round the bottom.
John grabbed an envelope and scribbled a picture that looked exactly like what we saw. Well, almost. John immortalized the sighting in this liner note, and it became part of his legend.
When I was with John, it was the most productive years that he had musically.
I always liked, was a record man, you know. I mean, I liked the studio always best once I got the hang of it and the control of it.
Jammed with Mick Jagger. Worked with Ringo. Elton John. David Bowie. Produced Harry Nilsson. That's a few things. Right?
One thing I loved the most was being in the recording studio doing production work with John. I earned production credits on some major albums.
I even sang backup on Number 9 Dreams. This is the toughest one. Yoko claimed that there's this therapist that, you know, can hypnotize him and help him quit smoking because he felt that his lungs were going short. You know, he didn't hold a breath long enough when he sang. Yoko called up and says, John should come home. And all of a sudden I got this horrible feeling and I didn't want him to go. And he turned around on the staircase and he looked at me and he said, I'll come back early. Whatever restaurant you want to go, we'll go and make the arrangements of going down to see Paul and Linda down in New Orleans because you're going to love it. Because I had never been to New Orleans. He turned to me, gave me a kiss. He said, I'll be back. And when he walked out the door, and the door slammed behind him, I had a strange feeling I wasn't going to see him back here again. So I didn't speak to him the whole weekend. I tried calling, and Yoko would say, he's sleeping, he's in session, everything, but then to get him on the phone. So finally, about I don't know how many tries, I said, listen, you know how your John doesn't like to miss a dental appointment. Please tell him. He's got one on Monday. And we met there, and we stood outside, and I could see he looked different. He sounded different. And afterwards, I went in one direction. He was going in the other. And I said, where are you going? And he looked at me and he went, home. I said, well, home is this way, pointing in the direction I was walking. And then finally he came over to me and he said, listen, Yoko's allowed me to come home. Allowed? And I said, whose idea was this? She goes, really, nobody, just came up. So I knew that's not what he was thinking. The week and a half before, we were about to buy a house. We had gone out there, we even took Julian. We were about to buy a house in Montauk. The next 5 years, I saw John on and off. And often we were intimate. And I know it meant a lot to both of us. It had been about a little over a year since I had last seen John when he called out of the clear blue. We spent an hour and a half on the phone. I said, where are you? He goes, I'm in Cape Town. And I went, South Africa? He said, we have to find a way for us to get together.
Never would I have thought that would be the last time I would talk to him.
This is the CBS Evening News with Walter Cronkite.
Good evening. The death of a man who sang and played the guitar overshadows the news from Poland, Iran, and Washington tonight. Former Beatle John Lennon, who was 40, was shot and killed outside his luxury apartment in New York. News of Lennon's death touched off a wave of shock and mourning around the world.
Devoted fans of John Lennon still gather at the site where the former Beatle star was murdered Monday night. Visiting overnight was Lennon's 17-year-old son, Julian, who flew in from London.
That Sunday, there was a little memorial, and I didn't want to come out, but Tony King and I decided to take a walk.
May meant something to John. She wasn't just a little scrubber that he picked up off the street. She helped him through a very difficult period of his life. She coped with a lot of shit. And she was a young girl, and her whole life was turned around as a result of this experience.
It never ended. And so when it didn't end, life ended it for me. What happened out there?
What is one of your fondest memories of May? Can you describe that?
The fact that she maintained such a great relationship with Mum. And the reason I got to see May a lot more. And the main reason I got to see May a lot more was because of Mum, you know. And
love you.
And I love you too. So, you know, that's, you know, one of the key things, I think, more than anything.
Yes.
Indeed. And look at us now, still here.
Still here.
Still alive and kicking. Who would have thought?
When I look back at our so-called lost weekend, when I think about my whole relationship with John, I know I wasn't the only woman he loved. He loved Cynthia. And yes, he loved me.
Answer for me, if there is any answers to anything, is love.
Next song you'd like to sing?
John!
Terrible, kill you. Is our latest record. Nyako! Or our latest electronic noise, depending on whose side you're on. Any road, we'd like to carry on with it. It's the last number. We'd like to thank you all for being so wonderful. And it's called Help. 1, 2, 3, 4.